Let's turn to Revelation chapter 7. We're continuing our study of the book of Revelation. And I suppose I meant to make a title slide, but if I would have made a title slide, I would have titled it The Antichrist and the Tribe of Dan. So I have to be perfectly honest with you. Every now and then I run into some information that kind of sends me on a 2-3 week journey. And I've been on one of those journeys for about the last 3 weeks. I just couldn't even really hardly stop trying to research it more and more and started digging more and more. And I'm going to preface what I'm going to say right now by saying this, that some of what we talk about tonight can't be proven completely from the scriptures. Okay, so I'm going to give you the scriptures that I believe allude to that. But then I'm going to also talk to you to some extent about information that is readily available if you wanted to look into it. And to me, it's just amazing the information and the dots that it's connected. I have to be careful that I don't try to go too far and try to explain too much, because of the fact that we're all at different levels in our understanding of various things. And that's not a bad thing. It just means that we don't all have the same level of understanding of various things, whether it comes to occult concepts or conspiracy theory type things. And so I just have to be careful that I don't get too carried away and try to talk about too much at one time. But, you know, let me just say this about the tribe of Dan. There's a lot of scholars that believe that the Antichrist will arise from the tribe of Dan. Okay, and there's various reasons for that. But let's look at the first concept, Revelation chapter 7. And it talks about in Revelation chapter 7 about the tribes of Israel that were sealed, okay? And so let's go ahead and start in verse 5, and we're going to just read. And it says, of the tribe of Judah were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Reuben were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Gad were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Asher were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Nephilim or Nephtali were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Manasseh were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Simeon were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Levi were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Issachar were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Zebulun were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Joseph were sealed 12,000. Of the tribe of Benjamin were sealed 12,000. So if you go back and you count, you have 12 different tribes. It's speaking of the tribes of Israel that were sealed in this book of Revelation. We're talking about the end times. Amen? And one of the things that I would like to point out to you is that the word sealed spoken of there is the same word sealed that's spoken of in Ephesians chapter 1 verse 13. Many of you should be familiar with that passage of scripture. Amen. Ephesians 1:13, that you've been sealed. After that, you heard the truth. Amen. I'm paraphrasing. After you heard the truth of the gospel and you believed. Amen. When you hear the truth of the gospel, then you must take your faith and you must believe in that truth. What is the truth of the gospel? That God has a plan. Hallelujah. God has a plan and he's been working it for thousands of years. Is this your first time showing up here? We draw chronological time frames all the time, and we show how God has methodically and progressively been moving through the midst of human history, all for the purpose on the front end when he called Abraham out was to bring Messiah to humanity. Messiah means the anointed one, the promised one that was going to bring salvation. Mankind finds himself born of Adam, born in sin. You sin because you're a sinner, amen? But God has a plan, and he sent the sinless one. Ultimately, through the nation of Israel, God gave us Jesus. Jesus walked the earth in his sinless form, amen, as a human being. Because the children were partakers of flesh and blood, he also became the same. He became our brother in that sense. He had no sin in him. And he lived that life sinless, and he offered that sinless life on the cross in payment for your sin and in payment for my sin. And when you hear that gospel, amen? You need to hear that gospel. You need to hear that good news. That's what the word gospel means, good news. Good news is, it starts with bad news. We're all in the same boat. We're in a bind. We're all born of Adam, and we're messed up, and we have a propensity. Some people call it a proclivity, a compulsion. We're being compelled to go towards things that we're not supposed to go towards. But the fact of the matter is that born again in Christ, the old man, hallelujah, dies, and a new man is resurrected to newness of life. That's the gospel. But you got to hear it first. You got to find a preacher that'll tell you. Amen. You got to hear it first. And then once you hear it, you have to take your faith You have to believe it, not just intellectually, but from your heart. Amen?
Amen.
And so when you believe that, according to Ephesians 1:13, you hear the gospel, you believe, you become sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. It's a down payment that shows you. Whenever you got saved, the Holy Spirit came to live on the inside of your heart. You listen, if somebody had to convince you you were saved, you might not have been saved. When you get saved, you know it. I'm not talking about the fact that you never messed up again after that. That's not what I'm talking about. When you get saved, you know it because you get sealed and the Holy Spirit lives in your heart and you'll never be the same. Amen. 12 tribes, sealed, same word. But there's some tribes missing here. And one of them, the main one that I want to talk to you tonight about is Dan. But also, if you look at this passage of Scripture, Ephraim is also missing. Now, there's reasons why Ephraim would be missing. Now, I didn't mean to get into all that, but I just wanted to point out, possibly it has to do with the idolatry. You know, whenever you look at a map and you hear the word Ephraim will be used time and again to speak of the whole northern portion of Israel. And so Ephraim was up in this area around here sometimes, and sometimes during, whether it be the kings or some of the other spots in the Bible, Jeremiah, some of the prophets, they'll utilize the word Ephraim to describe the whole northern part of the country of Israel, the collective 10 tribes that were up there, and the fact that they were knee-deep, for lack of better words, in the midst of idolatry. That could be one of the reasons why. That's not what I'm saying, though. I personally believe, if you'll notice, that Joseph, if you've done any study of the Bible, you'll never see Joseph listed as one of the tribes, one of the 12 tribes of Israel, anywhere in the Bible except that I know of in the book of Revelation. Nowhere else is Joseph listed as a tribe. You remember the story of Joseph, right? We'll talk a little bit about it tonight as we move forward. But Joseph was the first natural born child of Rachel. Amen? He was the one with the coat of many colors. Remember what his brothers did to him? Matter of fact, it's a good place to introduce this concept. You remember what his brothers did to him? Sold him into slavery, right? But what did he turn around and do for his brothers? He gave them food. He saved them from what? A 7-year famine. He's a type of Christ. Joseph was highly favored by the Father, amen? Joseph was sold out by his brethren. Jesus was sold out by his own nation as they turned him into Rome and had him crucified on a cross. But whenever it came back around, whenever the time was right, hallelujah, Joseph, amen, was able to save his brethren from the tragedy. And through it all, God had set it all up. And the same thing will happen with Jesus. On the front end, his brethren sold him out, but on the back end, he will save them, amen, because they will connect themselves in an unholy union with the Antichrist. And that's where we've been, actually, for the last several weeks. We've been talking about the Antichrist. We started off on the Daniel 9 prophecy, and we ended up talking about the Antichrist, and we've talked about many aspects regarding the Antichrist. And I really feel like after this week, we're probably going to be done talking about the Antichrist, at least focused upon him. All right. So so regarding Joseph, you never hear him spoken of as a tribe, because while Joseph was in Egypt, he had two children. One was named Ephraim, one was named Manasseh. Manasseh was the oldest born child. So the oldest born child is supposed to get the birthright. If you read anything about the scripture, whenever Jacob, old in his years, can't see very well, goes to bless the two boys, he crosses his hands. You remember that? He lays his right hand on Ephraim, which was the younger child, and his left hand on Manasseh. And Joseph tries to tell him, no, no, father, don't do it. He says, this is what I'm doing. Don't mess with me. I know what I'm doing. And he gives the birthright blessing to Ephraim, which is the younger child. Ephraim's not in here. That doesn't mean Ephraim's not here, because the truth of the matter is Manasseh was really the older one. And Ephraim he was a larger tribe during the time frame physically. And now we're talking about a spiritual end to the whole thing. And Manasseh's name, who was the firstborn, is actually listed here. It doesn't mean Ephraim's not there. It's the good possibility is that he's hidden in Joseph. Does that make sense? Because he's Joseph's son, and Joseph is actually the one that should have been the rightful one anyway, because he was actually the son of Jacob. Amen? But for some reason, Dan's not there. Dan's not there, and so we really need to look at this. And many scholars do believe that Dan will be the tribe that the Antichrist will come from. So I put in this next slide here, out of Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, I put two serpents. Because it says right here in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, it says, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. It shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. Now, I have to tell you that this passage of scripture, I've read it many times, I've studied it many times, I've preached it. If I don't talk about this passage of scripture two times a month, I don't think I talk about it much at all, right? But and every time I go back to it and really ponder on it, my understanding of it goes a little bit deeper. And you know, my first understanding of the scripture really had more to do with the fact that there were going to be born again believers, and that there were going to be worldly people who were running after the things that Satan offered, and that there was going to be a contention and a war between those two groups of people. Here I am, a born again Christian, and I'm about to tell you about Jesus out on the street, and here you are, a worldling, and you still living for the devil, and you and I are going to be at contention with one another because you're not going to like the things that I have to say to you. And if you backtalk against me, or not say backtalk, but if you give me a piece of your mind, I probably won't like the things you're going to have to say to me. But you know, it's much more than that. It's not just that these people that are following after Jesus and these people that are following after the devil. Some people would even say that it has to do with the sons of God and the daughters of men. That it has to do with the fallen angels that cohabited with the daughters of men and produced giants that were on the land. We've been talking a lot about that lately. Most of you that have been coming to the Bible study should be very familiar with that terminology. And you should be, as far as I'm concerned, you should be a little bit thankful for that, because there's a lot of people in most churches that don't even, never even heard that before. And it's all throughout the scriptures, and it matters because it has something to do with the plan of the enemy to try to destroy the plan of God. Amen? And so we need to be aware of those things. But I believe that it's even more than that. As a matter of fact, I believe personally that I see another aspect to this passage of scripture. And let's just think about this for a second. Who do you think, when it says, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed, who do you think her seed is? Ultimately. Now you could say, well, preacher, her seed is Israel. You could say that.
Jesus.
Amen. Because ultimately we know that God, what did I say? God was bringing Messiah to humanity. Through Abraham, he created Israel, but ultimately through Israel, what did he do? He gave us Jesus. The Apostle Paul said that right in the book of Galatians chapter 3. He said, not seeds as of many, but your seed, which is one, which is Christ. It was one seed, Jesus. Amen. That was the plan. Amen? And so if this is true, if this passage of scripture, long before there was ever a calling of Abraham, long before there was ever the creation of a nation called Israel, the one seed spoken of in this passage of scripture is speaking of Jesus, then the question that I'm asking is that who would the seed of the serpent ultimately be? In other words, if you were talking about the Messiah, the promised one, it stands to reason if you have a type, then you have an anti-type. If you have a Christ, then you have an Antichrist. Amen? And so we see early on in the passages of Scripture the introduction and the idea that we have the seed of the woman, which will ultimately be Messiah, which we know now is Jesus, and that there will also be the seed of the serpent, which will attempt to usurp and constantly. Now listen, at the same time, we're talking about the end of days. We're talking about 2000, we're talking about 33 AD, Jesus goes to the cross, and now we've been living in the church age for 2,000 years, and the Antichrist doesn't come to the end, and then Jesus is going to come back and destroy him with the sword of his mouth. But that doesn't mean for all those thousands of years in between that there wasn't still enmity between the spirits, amen, the Holy Spirit and the spirit of Antichrist fighting and striving and at enmity with one another. But there's coming a day whenever this is really going to happen, amen, and it's going to go down. And the Word of God says in Revelation 19 that with the sword of his mouth he will smite them at the Battle of Armageddon, amen. And the Word of God says that he will rule the nations with a rod of iron. Isaiah, I think it's chapter 7 or chapter 9. And so, was that?
Is there a lineage of Satan?
I believe that there could be, absolutely. I mean, you know, we could probably get into that right now, but whenever we teach occult exposure, we'll talk about that. Many people have written, as far as for this Illuminati information, many people have written voluminously on the fact that there are Illuminati bloodline families, Luciferian families, who have kept track of their lineage. And so to answer your question, I believe that, and we've even talked about that some. in the Bible studies. People that own the banking industry and other powerful globalists that are ruling the world in a physical sense, but under the power and the direction of the liar himself, in order to try to bring this world back under a one world dominion, just like it was forming at the Tower of Babel, and the confusion of the languages. We've talked about this recently. And from that time frame moving forward, well, let's just say it. September 11, 2000, you can Google that. Herbert Walker Bush, George Bush Sr., gave a speech, and I think in the speech he said New World Order four times, exactly 11 years to the day before 9/11. And his, you know, and well, I will just tell you this, I've done enough research to know that the number 11 is a major occult number. And so all I'm trying to say is that's just one example right there of something that's really strange going on that you keep talking. And if you just tried to Google and do research on all the people that have talked about a new world order, and you just do just a little bit of research and digging in that, I'm telling you right now, your eyes will be opened. And so the question was, is there a lineage of the Antichrist or of the seed of the serpent? I believe that there is. You know, and once again, we can't necessarily always prove it completely, but this is what we're looking at here in this passage of Scripture. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, it says that there's going to be enmity between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. Let's go real quick to Genesis chapter 49 and look at this prophecy. So this is right after Jacob. This is right after Jacob blesses Manasseh and Ephraim that I just told you about. And now he begins to speak prophetically over his boys' lives. And this is what he says about Dan. It says in verse 16 of Genesis chapter 49, Dan shall judge his people. Well, wait, hold on a second. Right now, I already got a question. I don't know about you, but I got a question. Why is Dan judging his people? Because, see, the Word of God says, let me go ahead and turn there for you real quick. John chapter 5, verse 21. John chapter 5, verse 21, Jesus says this about himself. For as the Father raises up the dead and quickens them, that's a King James word for gives them life, even so the Son quickens whom he will. In other words, he gives life to whom he will. For the Father judges no man, but has committed all judgment unto the Son. So if all judgment has been given unto the Son, then why, and Jesus comes from the tribe of Judah, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, why is Dan now prophetically spoken of in this passage of Scripture as being a judge for Israel? I think I can rectify it for you, but give me a second. John chapter 5, verse 43, it says, this is what Jesus said, I come in my Father's name, and you receive me not. If another shall come in his own name, him you will receive. So there's coming another one at another time, and we know that this is speaking, at least in my opinion, of Daniel chapter 9, verse 27. We studied this passage of Scripture for probably 3 to 4 weeks. And so if you want to go back and watch some of those videos, they're all on YouTube. It says in Daniel 9, 27, he, that's talking about the Antichrist, you just got to take my word for it. We broke it down verse by verse, word by word when we studied it. We can't do it again. He shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. The Antichrist is going to have a covenant with the nation of Israel. And in the midst of the week, in the middle of the week, he shall pause the sacrifice and oblation to cease. In other words, he's going to put an end. The temple will be rebuilt. He's going to say that he's in covenant with Israel and allowing all this to happen. And in the middle of this week, it's really a time frame of 7 years. We talked about all of that. In the middle of that time frame of 7 years, in the middle of that 7 year period, 3.5 years, the mid-tribulation point, he's going to break the covenant that he had with Israel, and we'll study it next week, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. He's going to set himself up. Jesus talked about it in Matthew 24. The abomination that causes desolation. That means the Antichrist is going to set himself up in the temple of God, and he is going to demand that he be worshipped as God. Jesus said in John 5:21 that judgment has been committed unto me. Jesus said in John 5:43, he said, I come in my Father's name and you don't receive me, but another will come in his own name and you will receive him. Daniel 9:27 speaks of the Antichrist coming and committing this, confirming this covenant with Israel and then breaking it. What I'm here to tell you is that God is going to use Dan as a tribe I believe is what it's saying here, as the person from the tribe of Dan to judge Israel. He's going to use the Antichrist to judge his people. Why? Because they've rejected Messiah. Listen to me. It's real clear in Revelation chapter 6. We've talked about this a lot too. The first seal is opened up. Did we not talk about that? The first seal is opened up. Who opens up the seal? The Lamb. You remember that? The Lamb opens up the first seal. Who's the Lamb? Jesus. Jesus opens up the first seal, and what's the first thing that comes forth? A rider on a white horse. Who's the rider on the white horse? He's got a crown. It says he's given a crown, and he's got a bow, but he has no arrows. He's the counterfeit Christ. He's the Antichrist. But who opened up the seal? The Lamb opened up the seal. So ultimately, even though God will use the Antichrist to bring judgment upon the earth because they refuse to believe the truth, that's what it says in 2 Thessalonians 2, because they refuse to believe the truth, God will send them strong delusion so that they would believe a lie. This is what they wanted. This is what they're going to receive. The Lamb is really the one that's exacting the judgment because he's the one that opened up the seal. But God uses the Antichrist through proxy, if you will, to bring judgment upon his own people. Why? For a greater purpose, just as he allows trial and tribulation in your life. Just as he allows you to find yourself in the midst of untoward circumstances so that he can get a hold of your heart and reveal things to you that are in you. Amen. To get a hold of you. And so it goes on to say in that Dan shall judge his people as one of the tribes of Israel. But look at this. Dan shall be a serpent by the way, an adder in the path that biteth the horse's heels so that his rider shall fall backwards. It talks about a rider falling backwards. It talks about striking of a heel. It's a horse's heel. But nevertheless, in Genesis 3:15, it talks about a serpent striking or bruising the heel. I looked up that word bruise in the Hebrew. It can also mean to launch at, to strike at. And so, you know, listen, if you read in the book of Genesis, the time that it talks about the serpent is in the garden, and then now it's talking about a serpent regarding Dan, all right? And so I just wanted you to be able to see that right there. So in Genesis chapter, this right here, if you'll look at these pictures, let's take a look real quick at where Dan got started. Let's see, Genesis. Genesis chapter 30. So if you'll remember the story, Rachel, Jacob loved Rachel. She was beautiful. And he worked 7 years for her. But then his father-in-law tricked him and gave him Leah instead. So he had to work another 7 years for Leah, but he got Rachel and Leah both. And as they're spending time, you know, I was kind of thinking about this earlier because Rachel ends up, we realize she's involved in idolatry, and we're going to talk about that for a second. And I was kind of cutting her a little bit too much slack, I think, because I was thinking, you know, poor little Rachel, she really didn't know any better. But the truth of the matter is she had already given birth for Jacob and given him children. So she had spent time with Rachel. She had spent time with Jacob, so she knew what Jacob was about. Nevertheless, she finds herself still connected to idolatry, and I'll connect that to Dan here in a moment. But it says in Genesis chapter 30, verse 6, and Rachel said, so she's barren. Let me slow down a little bit. She's barren. Leah's giving offspring, amen, she's having children, and Rachel can't have any children. And so what she does is that she kind of takes a trick out of Abraham and Sarah's hand whenever Sarah asked Abraham to go lay with the handmaiden, Hagar, remember that? And they produced Ishmael. She asks Jacob to go lay with her handmaiden, which was Bilhah. And whenever he lays with Bilhah, she conceives a son. And Rachel says, God has judged me and he's heard my voice. And she named the boy Dan. And so in reality, Dan is the biological offspring of Jacob and Bilhah. But it's shown that it's Rachel's offspring. Amen. And she's the one that actually names the child. And so let's turn real quick to Genesis chapter 37. I wanted you to see, this has to do with Joseph and his brothers. Because this is where it all started. You remember earlier how I talked to you about Joseph and how he was sold by his brothers? Mm-hmm. I never really had noticed this before until I started studying this. I always wanted to blame it on Reuben and Simeon because they were the oldest ones and they were the most well-renowned. And they were the ones that ended up selling him as a slave. But in reality, it all started with these other, so Rachel's handmaiden was Bilhah and Leah's handmaiden was Zilpah. And they both had two children for Jacob. So there was four boys that weren't for Rachel and Leah. And it says right here in Genesis 37, verse 2, these are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock. Remember, Joseph was Rachel's biological son. Amen. She gave birth to Joseph. After the handmaiden had given birth to these two boys, she finally actually conceived and gave birth to Joseph. So Joseph was 17 years old. He was feeding the flock with his brethren, and the lad was with the sons of Bilhah, which was the oldest being Dan, and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Now Israel loved, that's another name for Jacob, loved Joseph more than all his children because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. And so it goes on to talk about Joseph's dream. That the only point I wanted to make to you was that whenever it talks about Bilhah, it's actually her two boys are there. The firstborn is Dan. And as we can see, that's where the trouble actually started. Joseph recognizes that they're doing evil. They're not taking care of their father's business. And he goes and he gives an evil report on them. And that's how everything actually gets started. I wanted you to turn with me now to Genesis chapter 31 because I want to talk about the sins of Rachel. Genesis chapter 31 verse 25. We'll just go ahead and read this part of the story. Now this is at the end, okay? This is after Jacob had both of his wives. He worked 7 years for Rachel. He worked another 7 years for Leah. And then he worked 6 years for the goats, right? Amen. And so this is after he's worked all that time. I thought that was interesting too. Sean pointed that out to me. 7 years for a bride and 6 years for a goat. Six, the number of man. 7 years. Anyway, that's another story. We won't go there right now. Then Laban overtook Jacob. Now Jacob had, this is Genesis chapter 31, verse 25. Then Laban overtook Jacob. So Jacob's left now. He snuck out in the middle of the night. He took his wives. He took his goats. He took everything that he could get his hands on. And he's like, I got to put me some space between me and Laban. It's time for me to make my move. But it says Laban overtook Jacob. Now Jacob had pitched his tent in the mount, and Laban with his brethren pitched in the mount of Gilead. And Laban said to Jacob, what have you done that you have stolen away unaware to me and carried away my daughters as captives taken with the sword? Wherefore didst thou flee away secretly and steal away from me and did not tell me, that I might have sent thee away with mirth and with songs, with tabret and with harp, and has not suffered me to kiss my sons and my... Do you think he's serious in that? I mean, I don't mean to pick on Laban, but he's already deceived Joseph. I mean, Jacob. He's not being sincere. He's just mad because Jacob pulled a quick one on him. It is in the power of my hand to do you hurt, but the God of your father spoke unto me yesterday. He had a dream like Pontius Pilate's wife, huh? Saying, take thou heed that thou speak not to Jacob, either good or bad. And now, though thou wouldest needs be gone, because thou sore longest after thy father's house, yet wherefore hast thou stolen my gods? That's the part I wanted you to see right there. Laban says, you didn't only take my daughters and all this stuff without telling me, but you took my gods. And that's what this picture represents up here. These things are called teraphim. And in verse 35, the word is images, is the last word of verse 35, images. But in the Hebrew, the word is translated from the word teraphim. And essentially, they were considered household gods. They were manufactured by a person who would manufacture gods. And this picture down here at the right is supposed to be a depiction of Rachel taking Laban's gods on her way out the door whenever she takes off with Joseph. But it goes on to say right here in verse 31, Jacob answered and said to Laban, because I was afraid, for I said, peradventure you would take by force your daughters from me. With whomsoever thou findest thy gods, let him not live. before our brethren, discern thou what is thine with me, and take it to thee. For Jacob knew not that Rachel had stolen them. I can assure you that Jacob loved Rachel so much, and he worked so hard for it, that had he known that girl stole them gods, he wouldn't have told Laban to do that, because he had no clue that Rachel had stolen them gods. I mean, I don't know that. Maybe he would have told him to do it, but I just don't feel like he would have. But anyway, verse 33, and Laban went into Jacob's tent and into Leah's tent and into the two maidservants' tents, but he found them not. Then went he out of Leah's tent, and he entered into Rachel's tent. Now Rachel had taken the images and put them in the camel's furniture and sat upon them, and Laban searched all the tent and found them not. And she said to her father, let it not displease my lord that I cannot rise up before thee, for the custom of women is upon me. In other words, in medical terms, we call that she was on her menses. She was in her on her cycle. And he searched but found not the images. So she tells him that she's on her menstrual cycle and that she can't get up, but she's actually hiding the images underneath there. And once again, these images are translated from the word teraphim. So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about that for a second. Let me see if I can do this without messing myself up too bad. Let's just talk a little bit about teraphim for a second. Josephus, if I'm not mistaken, he was an ancient Jewish scholar, and he made mention of this, but there's also other mentions in archaeological documents, and Jewish tradition says that Abraham's father was actually a maker of idols. And so this was just interesting information for me, and so because it was interesting, I figured I'd share it with you. Abraham's father was a maker of idols. Jewish tradition reports that Abraham's father, Terah, manufactured and sold idols. And then I put the scripture that talks about Abraham's father, and that you see his name, Terah. And that's actually where the word teraphim comes from Abraham's father's name, which was Terah. And so Abraham's father is where we get that word teraphim from. And so, you know, it's an amazing thing that God calls out from amongst the world, amen. It doesn't matter what manner of person that you are. Abraham's father was a maker of idols, yet at the same time, God chose to use Abraham as the man through which he would bring forth, salvation, create the nation, hallelujah, and through the nation, give us Jesus. Now, I wanted to just kind of give you an idea about the teraphim, because now I want to go to Judges chapter 17, and I want to connect this back to Dan, all right? And part of the reason that I want to connect this back to Dan has to do with a prophecy out of Daniel chapter 11, and you don't have to turn there. You can go to Judges chapter 17. But in Daniel chapter 11, verse 37, I'm going to read this to you. This passage of scripture is referring to the Antichrist. Neither shall he regard the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any God, for he shall magnify himself above all. Now, I can't tell you with certainty that this is what it means, but it's what it sounds like to me. He's definitely not going to have any regard for the God of his fathers. And so people interpret this as though he's Jewish. The Antichrist in some way, shape, or form will be Jewish. There's a lot of, he will have Jewish roots. A lot of people didn't know this, but Hitler had Jewish genes in him. His mother was a Jew. And they hid all that. And nobody knew about it. Now whether or not he will be openly Jewish, some people say that the nation of Israel won't sign an agreement with anybody that's not Jewish. Maybe that's the case. I don't know. I mean, I know that right now, recently, in the news, correct me if I'm wrong, you can do your own research, but Iran and Obama just made some kind of a deal, didn't they, about allowing Iran. I don't watch the news anymore, so call me down if I'm lying. Iran and America, they just backed them up, let them move forward with their nuclear program. They're going to have some kind of, you know, inspections to make sure they don't produce a bomb, okay? And so they're going to do all that. Well, supposedly, one of the Saudi princes approached Israel and told them, hey, we're on your team. And let me tell you why they would do that. Because there's a difference in the types of Muslims that they have. You got Sunnis and you got Shias. And the Sunnis and the Shias hate each other. The Shias are from Iran and the Sunnis are from Saudi Arabia. And so their hatred goes way back. I'm telling you, I've seen some bad stuff as I've studied these two different... So my point is that you don't know... that there's the possibility. I mean, you don't have to agree with me. It's okay. We're all big. We're grown-ups here. But you know, for all we know, Israel could maybe go into covenant with a Muslim. If the Muslim nation's going to say, hey, you're in a bind and we're here to help you in the midst of this, you understand what I'm trying to get at, is that we cannot be definitive on that. And that doesn't mean that a Muslim couldn't have Jewish roots that we didn't know about. And so what I'm trying to say is that there's a lot of different factors pertaining to the Antichrist, and we don't understand how they're all going to come about, but I think that maybe some of the information that I uncovered might help us at least understand some of those things tonight, and then maybe, again, you might not agree with it, and that's okay. But Daniel chapter 11, verse 37, he shall not regard the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women. I don't know, he may not be openly homosexual, but I think he's going to be homosexual. It wouldn't be surprising to me. It's the spirit of Antichrist. It's all over the earth right now. It's pervasive. He goes on to say right here, and nor any god, for he shall magnify himself above all. Because he wants to worship. The Antichrist wants to be worshipped. All right. And so now we're back at Judges chapter 17. And so what I did was I introduced you to the fact that Rachel was an idolater. Right? She stole her daddy's idols. And Rachel is the mother of Dan, right? And so I wanted to show you and make a connection now that we're going to look at the tribe of Dan and through the eyes of Daniel's prophecy, saying that he will not regard the God of his fathers, all right? This is a long passage of scripture. We're going to read some of it out of chapter 17, and I'll be honest with you, I think we're going to read most of 18 because I think that I could tell you the story, but I think we should read it and talk about it. It says right here in Judges chapter 17, verse 1, and there was a man of Mount Ephraim whose name was Micah. He's not the prophet. He's just another man talking about during the time frame of Judges. And he said unto his mother, the 1,100 shekels of silver that were taken from thee, about which thou cursest, and spoke of also in mine ears, behold, the silver is with me. I took it. And his mother said, blessed be thou of the Lord my son. So he's admitting to his mom he stole some shekels of silver. And she says, blessed be the Lord my son. And when he had restored the 1,100 shekels of silver to his mother said, I had wholly dedicated the silver unto the Lord from my hand for my son to make a graven image and a molten image. Now therefore I will restore it unto thee. Now we need to slow down for a second. Because, I mean, if you have a critical thinking mind, you should be asking some questions already. Because she said, I dedicated it to the Lord. And the Lord's capitalized there. And these are people that are Israelites. But if you knew anything about the time frame of the judges, four different times it says in the book of Judges, there was no king in the land and the people did what was right in their own eyes. Nobody was serving God. They were serving false gods. They were blatant devil worship. And people were knee deep in a mess. And they were serving in idols. And this is what's basically going on. And they don't know the difference. They think that they're serving God, but the reality of it is that they're serving idols. Does that sound like anything else that you've heard of in modern times? Mm-hmm. People that literally think that they're serving God. We're not trying to pick on anybody. We're just trying to make a point. They think that they're serving God, but in reality, they're serving idols. Mm-hmm. It's another God by another name, and they're calling it Yahweh. They're calling it Jehovah. They're calling it Jesus, and it's not the same Jesus. Mm-hmm. All right? He said, you shall make no graven images. And you don't bow down to them. And you don't kiss their feet. And you don't call them father. And you don't kiss his ring. You kiss Jesus. That's what it says in Psalm, I believe it's chapter 2. Or, Psalm 2 or 10. Psalm chapter 2. Kiss the Son. Amen. Because he's the king. And so anyway, it goes on to say right here. Yet he restored the money unto his mother. And his mother took 200 shekels of silver and gave them to the founder. What does that mean? Well, a foundry was a place where you melt metals and you form images. And so a founder is a person who does that type of work. And so they brought the shield silver over there to the founder and he melted it down and he made graven and molten images. It doesn't tell us exactly what it is, but the molten images that Israel had a history with were what? Golden calves. Y'all remember that? In the wilderness? And the man Micah had a house of gods, and he made an ephod. That's why I have this picture up here, because it's an ephod. And the ephod, that people on the camera, you can't see this, but the ephod is actually this robe-type apron that, and you can see it on the front here. I mean, there's two different depictions of it. because one was never found, so they just assumed based off of it. And so, and this is the breastplate that has the 12 tribes and their stones connected to it. But so the ephod was worn by a priest. And so Micah, this idolater, along with his mama, they build these images, and he makes an ephod. And then he goes on to say that he made his own gods and teraphim. You remember those little household gods I showed you? Those little pictures? That's why I wanted to see that. Because, see, Rachel took them from her daddy's house, and these things are being used in idol worship. And he goes on to say, in those days, there was no... Oh, look at this, verse 5, I'm sorry. Ephod, teraphim, and consecrated one of his sons who became his priest. He's just basically doing whatever he wants. He's making idols. He's making an ephod. He says, son, you're going to be my priest. If you did any study of the Old Testament, you can't do that. It's got to be one of Aaron's sons from the tribe of Levi. You can't just make anybody you want to be your priest. And so he does all of these things. But look at this, verse 7. Here's his blessing coming his way. It says, and there was a young man out of Bethlehem, Judah, the family of Judah, who was a Levite, and he sojourned there. And so next thing you know, he ends up hiring this Levite to be his priest. He says, hey, this is perfect. I got molten images. I got an ephod. I have everything that we need. Won't you come and be my priest? Now let's go to chapter 18. It says it again. In those days, there was no king in Israel. And in those days, the tribe of the Danites, that's Dan, sought them an inheritance to dwell in. For unto that day, all their inheritance had not fallen unto them. Let's see if we got a map. So if you can see on your map, you may not even be able to see it. That's I think the next one's a little bit bigger. Yeah, I think I blew that up a little bit. I don't know if you can see it or not, but if this is Dan right here, see that? But Dan's actually down here. I should have pointed that out to you. So, this is Dan here. This is actually what was given to them whenever they first conquered the land. But it's saying that it was too small for them. I'm just trying to explain to you this story. And so, now that spot up there. So, what ends up happening is that these Danites, they started down here somewhere. This was their land, and it was too small for them. So, they started to travel towards a certain particular place. And whenever they get to this particular place, they're kind of, we're going to read it, but let me just show it to you real quick. It says right here, it's approximately 125-mile journey, and they start off through this place here, Kiriath Jearim, and I wanted to point that out to you, because when they got here, this is, and up here is whenever they took Micah's priest. And then they go up here to this place called Laish, and they end up naming this place Dan. But I don't want to forget and tell you that whenever they came here, they also named this place Mahan and Dan. And the reason that I'm pointing that out, I don't want to just forget about it, is because at the very end, I'm going to try to tie some things together to show you how Dan had a habit of naming places after himself, okay? I think that you'll find this kind of interesting at the very end. But nevertheless... So here's the story in Judges chapter 18. The Danites, the children of Dan, verse 22, sent their family 5 men from their coast, men of valor from Zorah and from Eshtaol, to spy out the land and to search it. And they said unto them, go search the land, who when they came to Mount Ephraim, to the house of Micah, so this is Micah's house, they lodged there. And when they were by the house of Micah, they knew the voice of the young man, the Levite, and they turned in there, and said unto him, who brought you here? And what makest thou in this place? And what hast thou here? And he said unto them, thus and thus dealeth Micah with me, and hath hired me. I'm his priest. And they said unto him, ask counsel, we pray thee, of God, that we may know whether our way which we go shall be prosperous. And the priest said unto them, go in peace, before the Lord is your way wherein you go. Then the 5 men departed and came to Laish, and saw the people that were therein, how they dwelt careless after the manner of the Zidonians, quiet and secure. And there was no magistrate. In other words, they didn't really have any government. They were kind of off by themselves. They didn't really have any security. And they came into their brethren, to Zorah and Eshtaol, and their brethren said unto them, what say ye? And listen, I'm just going to go ahead and tell the story because it's kind of long. What ends up happening is that they go back to where they were and they get 600 fighting men. And they head back up through this area of Ephraim back to Micah's house. And when they show up over there, they tell this Levite, they say, hey, who do you want to work for? Do you want to be a priest for one man, or do you want to be a priest for a whole tribe? And he says, that sounds like a great deal. If you're going to pay me more than what Micah can pay, then I'll go work for you. And so what ends up happening is that the Danites, these 600 men, they take all these teraphim, because that's what he had, right? He made teraphim. He went to the founder and he had teraphim made. He had molten and graven images made. And he also had an ephod. So they took all that stuff along with the priest and they kept on marching up north towards this place called Laish. And whenever they got there, it says that they slaughtered everybody in Laish and they changed the name from Laish to Dan. All right? And so essentially, that's what happened in that particular story. I wanted you to see, though, the idolatry of Dan. In another passage of Scripture, and I think I actually forgot to put it here, if you'll remember in the book of Kings, do you remember whenever Jeroboam, whenever Solomon failed God, do you remember that? And he built altars to the false gods? I know we've talked about that many times in the Bible study because it caused a split in the kingdom. That's whenever the northern and the southern kingdom were split. Solomon built altars to Chemosh and Molech, and because of that, the kingdom was split. The 10 northern tribes and the 2 southern tribes, Benjamin and Judah. And whenever that happened, the northern tribes were under the rule of Jeroboam. Well, King Jeroboam said that he had to build another altar because if he didn't build a new altar, everybody would go to Jerusalem to worship, and that the king of Jerusalem would steal the people's hearts and would reunify the nation and come against him. So what he did was he made 2 molten golden calves. And I'm glad that I remembered this because I wanted to mention this because it has to do with the idolatry of Dan. I'm trying to make a point. Dan is an idolatrous tribe. They always have been. And from the get-go. And so whenever they ended up, it says that he put 2 golden calves. One he put in Bethel. Remember we preached about that a couple of weeks ago where Jacob laid his head, but this is later. He put 1 golden calf in Bethel and he put the other one in Dan. So Dan is the northernmost part. Now that they've come up and they've taken this land, this is the northernmost part of Israel now. All the way down to what they call Beersheba. So if you ever read a scripture and it says from Dan to Beersheba, it's just talking about the whole range of Israel, right? And so he put one of those gods up in Dan, and he put another one in Bethel. So I'm trying to prepare in your hearts and in your eyes and in your minds to see that Dan was an idolatrous tribe and connecting it back to the fact that the Antichrist will have no regard for the God of his fathers. And really the main passage of Scripture so far has been that Dan is a judge for his people, and that he's also like a serpent on the pathway that's hidden, and connecting the serpent back to the serpent of the garden so far, okay? And so now the next passage of Scripture that I wanted to talk to you about was, I had this thought about 2 lions, and we don't even really have to turn there at this point. But in Genesis 49, 9 and 10, if you remember, this is this is Jacob, and he's prophesying. We already read this prophecy over Dan, right? Where he says, Dan will be a judge of his people, and he will be a serpent by the path, and he will strike the heel of the horse, and the rider will fall back. Well, before that, in Genesis 49, 9, he speaks of Judah. And this is what he says. He says, Judah is a lion's whelp. The scepter shall not depart from Judah. Now, we've talked about that a lot, right? That passage of Scripture, y'all remember me talking about that? It says the scepter, what is the scepter? The king's staff? A king held a scepter, right? The scepter shall not depart from Judah. Judah is the tribe through which the king of Israel, the eternal king, would reign. We know that to be a fact because 1,000 years after this, in 2 Samuel 7, God tells David, when you go to sleep with your fathers, I will establish your throne for your seed, and it will be an everlasting throne. David was from the tribe of Judah. Amen. And so the scepter shall not depart from Judah. And then the rest of the scripture actually says, until Shiloh come. And the rabbis all agree, and the interpretation in the Hebrew is that Shiloh means to the one to whom it belongs. So the scepter won't depart from Judah till it comes into the hand of the one to whom it belongs. We understand that that's Jesus, and there's coming a day when he will rule and reign. But look at this in Deuteronomy 33. And of Dan, he said, Dan is a lion's whelp, and he shall leap from Bashan. So who's the lion's whelp? Is it Judah or is it Dan? Well, so I started thinking about some other passages of the scripture. Revelation 5:5. And one of the elders saith unto me, weep not. Behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, he has prevailed. But look at 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour. And so we see this picture of two lions. Amen? And one lion is the lion of the tribe of Judah, but we see another picture of another lion. And in Scripture, in the New Testament, both Jesus, the Christ, and also the devil are representative of lions. Now, I had a little bit of fun with this thought, but, you know, I was thinking about this. I always knew that there was something to this movie. And I know that Disney put a lot of magic in it and a lot of different things. But just think about this. This is the kind of stuff that hits me later. Like, I'm not even really thinking about it at the time. The passage of Scripture in Genesis 49, 9 and 10 says that Judah is a lion's whelp. A lion's whelp is a baby lion cub that grows up. And it says, who will rouse him when he gets old? In other words, he's going to be a lion to be reckoned with when he's grown up. He's coming back. He came riding lowly on a donkey. He's coming back on a white stallion with a sword coming out of his mouth. Amen. And the question is, who's going to rouse him when he shows up that way, right? It says that Judah is a lion's whelp, but then it says, and the scepter shall not depart from Judah till Shiloh comes. It's talking about a lion king. In the same two verses, is it not? I mean, it talks about a lion, and then it talks about a scepter, and it's talking about a lion king. It just is. But then I started thinking about lions. And I started thinking, I had to go research lions again, because I knew I'd seen this on National Geographic before, that you have, whenever you have a pride of lions, you have a dominant male, and they allow those male lions to hang around in the pride for a period of time, but then when they start getting big and testosterone starts kicking up in their bloodstream, they kick them out. While the dominant male is still big enough to run them off, he runs them off. And they become scavenger lions. They don't have a pride. They don't have any female lions to take care of. And they hunt together and they fight together. And many times they'll gang up together and try to take over somebody else's pride. Okay? And what you have in this situation, I started thinking about, it's a perfect picture, if you will, of Christ, Antichrist. The truth of the matter is that Scar in this story, I know this seems maybe a little bit silly, but Scar in this story has been kicked out of the pride. And the fact of the matter is that the enemy of our soul rose up in pride and he was thrown out. Jesus said, I saw Satan fall to the earth as lightning. Now, we don't have to sit here on this Lion King motif. I'm talking about the actual way that lions operate in the midst of it. I didn't use the scripture and call them lions. The word of God called them lions. If you think God doesn't know how lions operate, come on now. He's the one that formed them and he's the one that created them. Now, there's a reason why I believe he used lions. So nevertheless, though, what Scar is trying to do the whole time is that he's trying to come back in deceptively and cause ruin. I was thinking about, he's got a little Simba right there in his hands, and I was thinking, isn't that how the devil does? He's over there trying to whisper something in Simba's ear, trying to turn him against his father. And the fact of the matter is that one of them, I know Disney messes everything up, and as far as I'm concerned, they probably would have flipped the role, and they think Scar is the Christ and the other way around. That's what I would believe. But nevertheless, because that's what they do. I mean, just a couple of the pictures I was looking at, they had skulls hidden in the background and you couldn't tell. I mean, we know that they're all messed up. I'm trying to make a point. So we can get off of that right now. But look at this. That's what they do. This is serious. It's a fight to the end. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. The seed of the woman and your seed, they will be at enmity with one another. Right? He said that you will bruise his heel And his heel will bruise your, crush your head. And there's been a constant conflict and a battle and a fight that's ensued. And I'm telling you that be sober, be vigilant, because your enemy, the devil, he roams around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And so I wanted you to see that to me it's interesting. That's why I wanted to show you those two scriptures, that this means something to me. I mean, am I just going off on this, or does it not mean something to you that two different tribes, it talks about two different lions, whelps, and then at the same time in this passage of scripture in the New Testament, once again, it talks about two different lions. One represents Jesus, the other one represents the devil. All right, and so anyway, that was basically the essence of what I wanted to talk to you about regarding that. Now, one last little thought before we close up. And I say little thought, I don't know how little it is. You really need to kind of like slap yourself in the face a little bit, just to make sure you're awake. Because I know I probably put some of y'all to sleep with all this information. In Judges chapter 5, verse 17, this is called the Song of Deborah. I don't know if y'all are familiar with this story or not, but boy, this is a good story. This is, again, during the time frame of the judges. And if you'll remember what I've already told you about the judges, is that they kept on falling into apostasy, worshiping false idols. And whenever they would do that, God would allow their enemy to overtake them. And so they find themselves, first off in chapter 4, under bondage and against this king called Jabin, who had a captain of his army named Sisera, who had them in bondage for 20 years. Once again, that's what the devil does, doesn't he? He wants to hold God's people in bondage. I thought this was an interesting story. I went back and reviewed it. And so they're holding him in bondage, and there's a prophetess named Deborah. And the word of the Lord came to Deborah and told her, bring the armies up into the mountains, and I'm going to draw Sisera's army down here by the river. And what ends up happening is that the Israelites begin to overtake them, and Sisera takes off running. And when he does, he sees a tent of one of the Israelites, or the Hebrews, who had made friends with his boss, who was King Jabin. So when he sees this tent, he thinks it's a safe place. And he goes in there, but what he doesn't understand is that the man of the house was cool with his king, but the woman of the house, she wasn't playing that. She loved her God. She loved God. Amen? Yeah. And so she says, yes, come on in here. Everything's fine. Come on in. And he's running, and obviously he's stressed. He says, can you give me some water? The word of God says she opened up a bottle of milk. I know they didn't have bottles back then. We need to go back and look at that translation. She gives him some milk instead. Well, you know, milk has this stuff in it called tryptophan, and it makes you sleepy. And so he drinks the milk, and obviously he becomes comfortable, and he starts to fall asleep. And the word of God says that Jael took a tent peg, and she took a hammer, and she walked up, and she put it on the temple of his head, and she smashed it down in his head, and she nailed his head into the ground of the ground. And so now, victory. Amen? And so, well, I thought it was interesting because here's Sisera, in my opinion, a type of the Antichrist in some way, because he's oppressing God's people. He dies of a mortal head wound. That was one interesting thing. But I know I'm supposed to be talking about Dan. Just give me a second. Dan's in this story, okay? And so, but when it's all said and done, they get victory. And then after the victory happens, Deborah writes a song. And she starts talking about how the heavens opened up and the rain came down. And if you start interpreting it, what you realize is that God told Israel to get up in the mountains, and he brought the enemy down by the river, and he allowed the heavens to start flooding down rain. And he talked about the fact that Sisera had 900 chariots. Chariots don't do any good whenever their wheels are just spinning. And when they can't go anywhere, Israel comes down from the mountains and attacks them. And Sisera's on the run, and he ends up dying. But in one of these passages of scripture in Judges 5:17, look what it says. It says, Gilead abode beyond Jordan, and why did Dan remain in ships? So during the midst of this whole fight, whatever's taking on, the Bible tells us that the tribe of Dan were seafaring people. They were in ships. They didn't help their brethren in the midst of this fight. And one of the things that I wanted to also tell you is that whenever Dan takes this area up here, it's up in this area here, And off here to the left is these two cities here called Tyre and Sidon. This whole area here was known as Phoenicia. And the Phoenicians, if you do any research, were some of the most famous and well-known seafaring people, meaning they were shipbuilders and they traveled the ocean. They had a very good a reputation for traveling the ocean. And what we see in this scripture, though, is that Dan, the tribe of Dan, is our seafaring people. And they're, and according to the map, they're in close proximity to the Phoenicians. So, what am I trying to tell you? Well, look, this is the story. And I uncovered some research. You know, Sean, I encourage you to look into this. Man, people that like to research, I encourage you to look into this. There's an alternate version of some things that have taken place where from this area here, the Danites, is what they were called, traveled to Greece. And from there, supposedly, traveled to the area of Rome. From there, had flooded the area of Britain. And even up here, it would have been up north, the name Denmark, which literally is translated in the way that it was originally written, was Danmark. And also, there was a river there called the Danube. The name Dan is all over this area. All right. Now, once again, you're not going to see this in every textbook that you read, but the idea is that the tribe of Dan literally left this area here. Some people even say during the time frame of Moses, some of them already had left and started to move into these areas of Europe. This connects so many different little dots concerning European conspiracy theories. Did anybody ever watch Shakespeare? That movie Shakespeare that came out a while back, y'all probably did. I used to watch movies all the time. Let me just tell you this. Y'all give me 5 minutes, okay? I'm watching this movie, and because I'm aware of the Bible, all of a sudden I'm kind of halfway falling asleep because the movie wasn't really that good. But there was a queen in there, and she was talking about it. All of a sudden she said something about the house of Judah. And when she said something about the house of Judah, I'm like, why did she say that? I mean, something like hit me in my chest. Why is this European British queen talking about the house of Judah? Well, I started researching. And I'm telling you, there's so many things connected to the European monarchy and how they say that they're connected. And it comes back to all those conspiracy theories about Mary Magdalene and all that stuff. All that stuff's connected like that, okay? Anyway, I knew that there were some various things going on with all that. Well, look at this. This is what one archaeologist, I got a couple of little printouts I have here, just some information to share with you. Y'all going to let me read this to you?
Sure, man. All right.
Archaeologists have also unearthed an 8th century BC Hebrew seal with the emblem of a ship. It is an obvious inference that the ancient Irish Tuatha De Danann, who traced their origin to the east, are related to both the Danann of early Greece and the biblical tribe of Dan. It is a known fact that the word Tuatha means tribe. Tuatha De Danann therefore means tribe of Dan. Well-respected modern archaeologist Cyrus Gordon, who was called the leading American archaeologist of the 20th century by Archaeology Magazine in 1996, also tied the tribe of Dan to the Tuatha De Danann of early Ireland. Gordon states, a group of sea people bore the name of Dan. The Bible tells how a segment of seafaring, Judges 5:17, Danites were part of the tribal system of ancient Israel. The Danites were widespread. Cyprus was called Ladan, the island of Danann. The same people were called Danuna, and under this name they appear as rulers of the plain of Adana in Cilicia. Greek tradition has their ancestor Danaus migrating from the Nile Delta to Greece. Note that the Israelites did in fact migrate from Egypt. So important was this movement that the Greeks afterward called themselves Danoi for centuries. Virgil also designated the Greeks as Danai. Both scholars see the influence of the Danites in Irish folklore and in the name of Denmark, the land of Dan. It is a mistake to accept the consensus and to imagine that sea people with enough striking power to change the course of history were unenterprising to the point of never sailing west of Gibraltar. Dr. Gordon also points out biblical evidence that the three of the Israelite tribes is described as navigational, Zebulun, Dan, and Asher. All right, this was something else interesting. Anybody watch Braveheart? Yeah. Anybody ever watch that movie? I love that movie. He fights for the love of a woman. He was a heck of a fighter, wasn't he? Anyway, if you don't like blood, don't watch that movie. So here, listen to this. This is some interesting information. Scottish constitution makes direct reference to the Scots, Israelite origins. The medieval Scots were the first nation to adopt a written constitution in 1320. It was called the Declaration of Aberwath. After the town where it was signed, it was by the same charter that the enlightened Scots adopted the format. This was back in 1320. It says, "In most holy Father and Lord, we know, and from the chronicles and books of the ancients, we find that among other famous nations, our own, the Scots, has been graced with widespread renown. They journeyed from Greater Scythia by the way of the Tyrrhenian Sea and the Pillars of Hercules, and dwelt for a long course of time in Spain among the most savage tribes, but nowhere could they be subdued by any race, however barbarous. Thence they came 1,200 years after the people of Israel crossed the Red Sea to their home in the west, where they still live today." And so basically the Scots, and it says the Norwegians, the Danes, and the English, they took possession. Basically the Scottish people were claiming that they had Jewish or Israelite ancestry. And I'm just trying to show you that the reason that I brought all this up, and once again, this can't be proven. There's a lot of evidence. I researched this for 3 weeks. There's multiple people. I mean, there's all kinds of evidences that this actually happened. Gold and treasures that were found, altars that were found in these areas that only could have come from Israel. But at the same time, you got to understand that in Europe is where Druid worship comes from, which is where Stonehenge came from, which already the tribe of Dan were idolaters. And so the idea is that they would have been bringing their idolatrous worship with them to this area and instituted it there also. Now, you know, there's probably some people that would have a problem with that. But let me just make a couple of points, and then I'm going to close. Number one, this is the area of Dan. There was a time frame whenever Assyria, which is around here, in the early part, my map's kind of shrunk down, handled all this area here. There's one scripture that says that the Antichrist was going to be an Assyrian. All right? Then, remember the scripture where it's talked about the little horn? Remember that? Out of Daniel? The little horn? Y'all don't remember that? Y'all already forgot? Yes. It's okay. I know. I'm like a word geek. And y'all forgot what I'm talking about. The Greece. You remember Greece? Alexander the Great, the little horn, the Antichrist? Yeah. Right? Okay, you remember what it says, and we just read it tonight, Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, where it said the prince of the people that would come. Do you remember who that was talking about? The people that would come? It was talking about Rome. Remember that? The Roman Empire, AD 70, Titus, they destroyed the temple. I know this is a lot of information. Just bear with me a second. I'm trying to make a point that is it possible if the Antichrist, and once again, I can't prove it. This is just a thought. How do we rectify all of these different aspects of the Antichrist? He's an Assyrian. He's a Jew. He's from Greece. He's from Rome. And all I'm trying to get at, is it possible? Once again, we won't ever know, but it's interesting to me. Is it possible that in Dan, just like whenever, how does the story go? That Levi paid tithes while he was still in Abraham's loins. Levi paid tithes to Melchizedek while he was still in Abraham's loins. In other words, Levi wasn't ever born yet, but whenever Abraham gave tithes to Melchizedek, then ever Levi actually had done it also. The point is that is it possible that in Dan, in the tribe of Dan, and all of these travels, if the Antichrist comes from Dan, that it meets all of this criteria that I was trying to talk to you about tonight? I don't know. I just thought it was interesting.